I'm Joel Whitney. It's great to welcome Salman Rushdie here. I've been a reader for a long time, and he's part of our ongoing author series. We also have people who are probably friends with Mr. Rushdie. John Irving is coming in November. Who else? Mary Gateskill is coming. Orhan Pamuk is coming. And I hope you'll look for those on the website, bklynlibrary.org. And without further ado, we're going to jump into the conversation. It's not going to be that long, maybe 40-minute conversation. Then we'll have Q&A with you all. You'll see the microphone over there. And keep your questions short when it comes to that and pointed. and then we'll have a signing here in this room. We'll sell books from our friends at Community Bookstore. That's Ezra in the back. And the signing will be out on the right wing if you're looking out the back door. So once again, welcome, and I'd like to get started. I'm going to use your bio from the book, but you need no introduction. Salman Rushdie is the author of 11 previous novels, Grimus, Midnight's Children, Shame, The Satanic Verses, etc., and one collection of short stories, East West. He has also published four works of nonfiction, Joseph Anton, The Jaguar Smile, Imaginary Homelands, and Step Across This Line, and co-edited two anthologies, Mirror Work and Best American Stories, 2008. He's a member of the Academy of American Arts and Letters and a distinguished writer in residence at New York University, former president of Pan American Center, and he was knighted in 2007 for his services to literature. I have a feeling you're our first knight to grace the stage, but it may not be the case. So congratulations on this book, which takes its title from what classic work?
Well, if you do the math, it's 1001 Nights.
Right.
And although, of course, the internet being what it is, there have already been a lot of people feeling the need to tell me that it doesn't work if there's a leap year.
Right, of course, right.
As if I didn't know that.
Right. So tell me about how quickly this book came together and what part of 1001 Nights you were thinking about, or if that was even the seed, or if that was added later.
Yeah, no, it was not just 1001 Nights, but I really was thinking about a whole range of what collectively get known as wonder tales, you know, which come from, some from India, some from the Arabic speaking world, and so on. Some of them are animal fables, some of them are kind of, you know, supernatural hero stories, etc. There's a whole range of different kinds of story. And I, in a way, what happened is after I finished my previous book, which was this very non-fictional memoir, I had a kind of emotional reaction against non-fiction.
Yeah.
And wanted to really go to the other end of the spectrum and do something very fictionally fictional.
Right.
You know, I know there's a kind of fashion right now, even in fiction, for things to sound a bit non-fictional. You know, there's a lot of very popular writing now is, at least gives you the sense that it's drawn very closely from the writer's experience. You know, and I'm thinking about writers like Elena Ferrante and, you know, Karlove Knausgaard and so on, who are very kind of hot right now. This is as far from that kind of writing as it's possible to be, because basically what I did was to try and take the manner of these ancient stories and use them to write a very contemporary story set in New York City. You know, so to use it not in any way to write a folkloristic Walt Disney genie kind of story, although there are genies in it.
Yeah.
I mean, I was just being asked just now about how could I sum up the book, and the three-word summary of the book is Genies Attack Manhattan. that's the kind of Hollywood high concept.
Yeah. Well, when you've had sort of a thrilling true story imposed on you, maybe the way that you both honor that by writing a memoir and then re-escape from that is...
Yeah, I mean, I do think what happened to me when I finished the book, I mean, A, as I say, it made me want to go back to fiction, but I think B, in myself, I think I really felt a real lightening of spirit, you know, I mean, I felt as if I'd put down some weight that I'd been carrying around for a very, very long time,
yeah.
and And you know, I felt unburdened, you know. And I think the kind of buoyancy of that is in this book in some way, because the book is oddly cheerful. I mean, it's unexpectedly optimistic. More optimistic, perhaps, than the times entitle us to feel.
Yeah.
But it is.
Well, I want to unpack sort of what's in the book momentarily. A quick story, though, about on this aspect of sort of fairy stories and wonder stories. Sorry to go into a first-person thing here, but I was on the hippie trail in Central America in the late 90s, and I just loved satanic verses, and I sort of knew about it. It was before the internet, so I'd heard about it. I'd heard about the controversy, but I sort of read it free of the controversy. It didn't sort of enslave me, and there was so much just muscularity of vocabulary and freedom of wordplay that I wanted to read everything I could find by you.
Oh,
and
that's great.
In Costa Rica, where I was, I found Haroon in a Sea of Stories and loved that. But I really loved your essays, Imaginary Homeland, which is really the articulation in many cases of what it felt like to live under fatwa the first time around. Some
Although
of those essays
written long before, you know.
Well, I mean, some of them like A Thousand Days in a Balloon.
Yeah, that was right.
That was some of them were speeches that happened in real time.
Yes.
And I loved those, but I went to this one hostel where you take a book and leave a book, and I had Jaguar Smile with me and Haroon, and I saw the Herman Hesse that I wanted, Narcissus and Goldman. And I traded yours, knowing that I still had the Jaguar Smile. I traded Haroon. And I picked up Herman Hesse. And I found a travel mate, a young Canadian, and we were going to the airport. And I asked her which one she had taken. And she said, no, you tell me which you took. And I held up the Herman Hesse. And she said, that was mine. And I said, well, what did you take? And she held up your book. And I said, well, that was mine.
And so you got married?
No. Sadly, I lost her at the airport. But I wish that's how it went. I mean, she was lovely. There is a magic in the way that you do fable and wonder stories. And you know, 1001 Nights is such a huge, impressive work, but it's sort of hard to take in as a novel. There's eight volumes in the shorter version,
and there's long stories and short stories in it. I mean, it's also, you know, because of Disney movies and things, so people think of it as a children's book, but it's absolutely not.
No, I mean, it's actually filled with sex.
And the language is very complex and so on. I mean, it's certainly not at all a thing that children could easily read. Although obviously there are children's versions of some of these stories, you know. But I mean, it's very interesting to see how these stories move across the world. You know, those stories, for example, just that compendium, a very large proportion of the stories in it are probably of Indian origin. They're probably Indian folk tales and fairy tales in origin. And at a certain point, they were translated into Persian, into Farsi, because that was the court language in India at the time. And so they made their way into the Persian-speaking world in the form of a collection which has been completely lost. There's a lost book. I mean, one of the great lost books of literature, you know, like Thomas Kidd's Hamlet, you know, which predated Shakespeare's, and we don't know how much Shakespeare borrowed from it. But this book called in Farsi, called A Thousand Stories, Hazar Afsane, is completely lost, but is clearly the source material for what became The 1001 Nights. And the only reason we even know about its existence is that it's referred to in other people's books. You know, and it seems as if the famous frame story of Shahrazad is already there in that lost book. And then it finds its way into Arabic and becomes The 1000 Nights and One Night. And then eventually arrives in Europe, initially in French, where it's translated by a man called Antoine Galland. And each step of the journey, some stories fall out and other stories are added. So that there actually isn't a canonical text. Really. So when it arrives in French, very strange things happen, which is that one or two of the stories that are added by Antoine Galland, which are not in the Arabic text, are some of the most famous stories, like the story of Aladdin, for example.
Right.
The story of Ali Baba and the 40 Thieves. First appear in the French edition. And what we are not clear about anymore is whether those were folk tales that Galland knew about and just decided to add, or whether he made them up. So it may well be that Aladdin is actually a French story.
Right. And then the other European translations were translations of the French.
From the French, yeah. And then eventually there were translations from the Arabic into English and so on. But it made, and actually to complete the arc of the journey, eventually I ended up in Latin America. And a lot of the writers of the so-called Latin American boom, you know, El Boom, which was Garcia Marquez and Borges and so on. Well, not Borges, is an earlier generation, but Garcia Marquez, Mario Vargas Llosa, Alejo Carpentier, blah, blah. They all said that they had been very influenced by the Arabian Nights. So this strange world of wonder story, you know, really spans the planet as these stories move around. And they are just some of the oldest and most beautiful ways of telling stories, you know. But the thing that I really hung on to writing this book is that even though these stories are full of, you know, ogres and genies and flying carpets and, you know, magic lamps and etc., even though there's all that, they're completely realistic when it comes to human beings. You know, so the people in the stories are all absolutely credible people who you absolutely believe as human beings. You know, and they have all the characteristics of any good novel. You know, they can be good or bad. They can be wily or cunning or deceitful or greedy or lustful or noble or, you know, whatever. They're people. You know, and so what happens in these stories is that extraordinary things happen to ordinary people. You know, and we see how ordinary people deal with the arrival of the extraordinary in their lives. I mean, that's really what these stories are about. You know, and I was thinking that we kind of live in a time. I mean, there's a phrase used in the book where it says that we're living in what's called the time of the strangenesses, and I think we do live in that. I mean, the strangenesses in the book are kind of surreal and bizarre. But I think we actually do live in a time that is very strange to many of us, because it's a time which is both very accelerated and metamorphic. You know, so things, not only is everything changing, but everything is changing at incredible speed, yeah. You know, incredible, bewildering speed. Technologies arrive and are outdated and replaced by other technologies and so on, you know. If you think about it, the gesture for call me within recorded history was this, right. Call me, you know. Then it became this, and now it's this. And so just an object as simple as a telephone has metamorphosed several times, you know, in within a very short space of time. So I just thought I wanted to make a picture of this world which is transforming in bewildering and sometimes frightening and certainly unexpected ways, and how do people deal with it? You know,
yeah.
That was sort of the first question from which the book arose, and then it got crazy.
Well, it's a nice arc to think of those stories from India and some cases the Middle East, going to Latin America, and then when some of your early books came out, I think Midnight's Children and certainly Satanic Verses, you were compared to Garcia Marquez.
Yeah, but I think it's two things. I think, first of all, there's a literary source material that we have in common. And secondly, what I found when I started going to Latin America a little bit, is that there are really enormous similarities, cultural similarities, even though these places are so far apart, you know, that they're both parts of the world with a very strong colonial history, for a start. I mean, you know, different colonialists, but same kind of power of the colonial presence. They're both parts of the world in which religion has been very significant. And again, you know, different religions, but still. They're both places where there's an enormous discrepancy between the rich and the poor. Although that's beginning to be the United States as well.
Right.
They're both places where there's a great deal of corruption, public corruption. They're places which have had military coups, et cetera, et cetera. You know, there's a whole range of things. Where when I would read some of these Latin American writers, I would think, I know that world. You know, I know that it's like the world that I knew translated into Spanish.
Yeah.
So I think there's that, but I mean, there are obviously many differences as well.
There's a lot of sources that you're both looking for,
yeah.
that pointed back to each other. I think Octavio Paz has a whole book on how India and Mexico are incredibly similar.
Yes, and you know, there are several books about, by writers from that from South America going to India, you know, and writing about it. So there's a lot
often as diplomats.
Yeah, a lot of cross pollination.
Well, let's talk about some of the amazing characters. Part of the book, you have this wee voice. So it feels like kind of you're not going too far with this idea that it's a study of jinn, which we often in the United States would call genies. The study of jinn in this wee voice, it ends up feeling like there may be scholarly material on jinn that you drew on, or that you made that up.
No, there is some of each. I mean, there is scholarly material which I did try and get to grips with, but then you know, in the end, when you're writing fiction, there's a point at which you have to put the research away, and just start letting your imagination work on it,
right?
You know, and so there's stuff that I made up.
But in Western theology, there's the orders of angels.
Yes.
How many orders of jinn are there?
No, the jinn have to be completely other than angels. They have no divine relationship.
Right, but you have dark jinn.
There's dark and not so dark. I mean, the jinn, on a kind of sliding scale, tend to vary from mischievous to malevolent.
Yeah.
You know, what they really like to do is to screw things up. That's their nature. The kind of granting wishes and all that is actually a very minor thing. That's in a very rare occasion when a jinn is jinni is the word jinn is actually the plural.
Yeah.
You have many jinn, one jinni. So that's where the word jinni comes from.
And a female is a jinnia.
Jinnia, yes. But that's the word jinni is which becomes jinni, because that refers to the singular.
Which becomes genius.
Which becomes genius. Sometimes.
Sometimes.
only when it's Robin Williams. I have a funny Robin Williams genie story to tell you, which I will.
Please do.
Some of the kind of world of the jinn that's in this novel is based on reading, but a lot of it is made up, I have to say. I mean, it is, for instance, true that the jinn are supposed to have their own world, for which the word Paristan translates literally as fairyland. You know?
Yes.
So, and in that world, they are quite well known to be lecherous, the jinn. So I decided I wanted one thing for them to have, one quality, which was genuinely, absurdly supernatural, and secondly, kind of funny. Mm-hmm. And what that is sex. So the jinn have sex all the time, just colossally, unendingly, inexhaustibly,
right,
have sex all the time for millennia.
Right.
and it struck me that if you really think about it, I mean, I looked at a lot of pictures about the jinn world when it's entered into art, you know, and it struck me there's not much to do there. You know, there seem to be no books. There aren't any movies. There's no TV.
You say they're made of fire, so the books.
Yeah, they're made of
just burn
the
up.
Jinn are made of smokeless fire, and the female jinn are made of fireless smoke. So the coming together of the Bengal female is the coming together of smoke and fire. You know, so, but they have really not much to do except have sex, and once you've done that for sort of hundreds of thousands of years, it kind of gets old.
Yeah.
And one of the reasons why they like coming here and meddling with us is because they find they have a sort of very ambivalent idea about human beings. And on the one hand, they're contemptuous of us because we're so feeble and they're so mighty. But on the other hand, they're kind of envious of us because we have more interesting lives. Because we do all kinds of things other than have sex. In fact, most of us don't have much sex at all. So there's plenty of time for other things.
So they're
kind of very curious about human beings because we're more interesting.
And you make them sound like they have a smaller range of emotions that they
yes,
can feel.
Yes, they don't. Yeah, they do.
They don't
I mean,
have
I think
finer
that's
emotions that humans.
That's
have.
True. They're not human. You know, they're not human. So they don't have what we have, which is depth of feeling, and soulfulness, and love, and things like that. they don't have those things. And in fact, so the main female character in the novel, who is a female Jinnia, the fairy queen, you know, really, who she's unlike most of her kin in that she actually is really fond of human beings, and in general, and one in particular. And gradually through the novel, one could say she becomes, she's sort of humanized. You know, she becomes capable of deep feeling, love, and self-sacrifice, and you know, all kinds of things which are human virtues, and not, and not supernatural ones.
Yeah. Who is this character that she loves? He seems to have
my name,
the root of your name, and you said, well, you said you wrote this to get away from autobiography. I don't know what to believe anymore, Salman.
Well, no, no. Well, you see, this there's this genuine existing philosopher who was 12th century. Lived in Cordova in Spain during the period of the Arab rule of Spain. And he was a very famous philosopher, known in the West as Averroes, an enormous influence on the philosophy, for example, of Thomas Aquinas, and even on the Florentine Renaissance humanists. You know, he was a great scholar of Aristotle, translator of Aristotle, and commentator on Aristotle. But his real name, Averroes being the Europeanization of his name, was Ibn Rushd. And so my father, when I was not even born, became such an admirer of his philosophy that he changed our family name to Rushdie in honor of this philosopher. You know, and so I didn't, I mean, I found out about that, not when I was a little boy, but when I was a teenager or something, you know, and I obviously became very interested in his philosophy. And so when I was at university, I read a lot of it, and I got the point. I thought this is a really very attractive thinker who is, in his time, in the 12th century, a very progressive voice, you know, a voice of reason and logic and science and tolerance and openness and all these excellent values. In 12th century Moorish Spain.
Yeah.
And I could see why my father was drawn to him, because I was drawn to him too. And then, bizarrely, I mean, this is when I was 20, kind of, you know, and then when the Satanic Verses came out and the attack on my work took place, I realized, shockingly, that we shared that too, that he, in his time, had been attacked by the fanatics of his time, who were Berber Arabs in Spain. And although he was a very influential man, he was a court philosopher, he was the personal physician of the Sultan, you know, they persuaded the Sultan to fire him. So he was not only was he fired, but he was exiled and sent into exile in a small village in the countryside outside Cordova, which was actually a village mostly populated by Jews who had been forcibly converted to Islam and were not allowed to therefore practice Judaism. So here's this philosopher who's not allowed to practice philosophy, exiled to a village of Jews who are not allowed to be Jews. And they got on very well.
So what do you make of that name change?
Andy had his books.
Echoing your own
history. Andy had his books burned. Yeah, I thought, you know, I know quite a lot about that.
Yeah.
And so it made him even more, I thought, how did my father, I mean, predict all this? It's kind of spooky.
Yeah.
Anyway, so it made him a very interesting character to me.
Is the takeaway that words matter and you become your name?
You know, I guess so. I mean, it is alarmingly prescient of my father's decision to change the name. Yeah. But what I did feel in those days when I was the one under attack, that at least I was, you know, the name was sort of like the right flag to be fighting under.
Yeah,
you know, because he was, if you're going to choose somebody to represent what you thought, it might as well be him, you know. Because anyway, so I always thought that he would fall into a book of mine at some point, because he's just so interesting to me.
And he dies early in the book, but that doesn't stop him from remaining in the book.
Well, what can happen with a book is that it tells you what to do, which is something you weren't planning to do.
Yeah.
So I mean, I had always thought there would be this prologue. What is now essentially the first chapter of the book, this prologue which takes place in 12th century Spain, in which this philosopher is visited by this fairy princess, and they fall in love and live together and have a large number of children. And he, meanwhile, is engaged in a philosophical argument with a conservative adversary, also a real person, the philosopher Al-Ghazali, who basically has a much more conservative, what we might now call extremist, version of religion. And they have this argument, and he's having this love affair, and he's in exile. And I thought that there would be that prologue, and then the novel would be about the descendants mm-hmm. of these of this extraordinary coming together of a supernatural woman and an actual historical figure, and then we would jump more or less, you know, 900 years more or less to the present day, and the novel would take place now. That's right. What I thought. But once I started writing him, and especially writing about his argument with his rival, I thought, you know, there's a way in which that argument between blind faith and tolerance, you know, between reason and unreason, you know, that argument's still going on. You know, we're still in the middle of that argument. And I thought, I've got to somehow keep these people arguing. And how do I do that when they've been dead for 900 years? Well, the answer, of course, is in fiction you can do
anything,
whatever you like. So I had to sort of somehow reanimate their ghosts, and for them to argue literally from the grave at each other.
You actually describe them as bodies of dust.
Dust, or even, you know, it's 900 years, so it's not even dust. It's the void where the dust used to be, yeah. You know, that becomes animated.
Yeah,
and they go on arguing. So. One of the big advantages of fiction over nonfiction is that you can do what needs to be done.
Right. It's lovely. I mean, that is, obviously there are echoes of the nonfictional sort of true argument that your life became after Fatwa.
Well, and all of our lives. You know, the point is that argument affects all of us now. It's not just me, you know.
You can do a lot with it when you can have dead little clumps of dust arguing hundreds of years.
So it becomes funny as well.
Yeah.
You know, I'm happy to say that everybody seems to be finding this book very funny.
It is very funny.
And I've thought that, you know, everything that I've written has had some edge of humor in it. And I mean, I've had a lot of people write to me about the Satanic Verses and say, who knew that it was a funny book? And the answer is, everybody who read it knew it was a funny book.
Right. Which excludes the people who attacked it, generally speaking. I mean, in Garcia Marquez, you have this long sort of narrative on family traits, which ends up sort of, you know, predicting what a lot of science would learn about the genetics and DNA. And I don't know if genes and genetics has a root in the word genie or gin.
I don't think so.
Genus, maybe. But you have something here that reminded me of that. You have this argument about whether the body and the soul are, which goes back to Aristotle, and you have our fairy princess wondering as she looks, I guess, at her dead lover and thinks about helping him continue this argument through her magic. Maybe in the case of true humans, their mind, their soul, their consciousness flows through their bodies like blood, inhabiting every cell of their physical being. And so Aristotle was right. In humans, the mind and body are one and cannot be separated. The self is both with the body and perishes with it too. She imagined that union with a thrill. How lucky human beings were if that was the case, she wanted to tell Geronimo, one of the incarnations of this marriage, who was and was not Ibn Rushd, lucky and doomed. When their hearts pounded with excitement and their souls pounded too, when their pulses raced, their spirits were aroused, when their eyes moistened with tears of happiness, it was their minds that felt joy. And so on. It's a lovely sort of culmination of this this playfulness you have that actually starts with a straightforward, almost kind of formal Oxford-style debate about whether secularism is the right approach to religion or a more open approach versus
about the mind-body problem, which is, are we something other than our body? You know, and you know, I mean, I have really no spiritual leanings. I'm fairly much kind of hardcore Hitchens-style atheist. But one of the things I think is absolutely evident to all of us is that we feel that there is a self in us which is not simply our arms and legs and head, you know, that we have that sense of ourselves, of having a self which is not physically limited, you know, and so what does that mean? And what do we deduce from that? You know, how do we understand ourselves if that is something, that selfhood, you know, of self-awareness, is really what makes us human beings, that the arrival of self-consciousness, you know, is something that creates sophistication, it creates the thing that we are, you know. Homo sapiens is the creature that knows it's a man.
Yeah.
You know, does a dog know it's a dog? Probably not. You know, does a pig know it's a pig? Probably, I mean, almost certainly not. You know, does a snake know it's a snake? You know, that say we know that we are us. You know, and that's a very, very complicated and sophisticated thing to know. So I invented this idea, which I gave to her, of if you like, the mortal soul, you know, of there being an essence in us which is not of the body, but which is limited by the body, and which is born with the body and dies with the body, but is not just flesh and bones, you know. So anyway, that's my attempt to just to try and explain why it is we feel this way, you know, because we do feel this way about ourselves.
I think in one of the essays on Imaginary Homelands, which I keep thinking of as you're speaking, I think you talk about how the sublime, I think it's Is Nothing Sacred is the essay, or maybe it was originally a speech. I know this is going back some years.
Yeah.
But you talk about how the sublime is a kind of religious feeling, and you sort of make the case that humans have religion, whether it's the revealed truth that some conservatives would want you to believe in or not. And that seems like that's related to the debate that they're having.
Yeah, I mean, I think religion is a consequence, not a cause. That's the point. I mean, I think there is a thing in us which often has found expression through these religions that we've invented. I mean, the other thing I think is that, you know, where religion comes from, all of them, is really, there are two big problems that human beings had to find answers to. And one is the problem of origins, you know, how do we get here? And the other is the problem of ethics, which is, now that we're here, how shall we live? You know, so commandments, etc. And religions become codifications of the various answers that people have found, or the various stories that people have told themselves, to try and answer those two questions, the question of origins and the question of ethics. And as such, they're very interesting.
Yeah.
You know, they stop being interesting when they acquire, you know, armies.
Right.
And different religions have been militant at different points. You know.
So when the stories remain open, I mean, you talk about how anything can happen in a novel, and do you believe it's the case that anything should be able to happen with or about the stories of religions? Would you go that far?
Well, I mean, I think the thing is that my view is that these things are the collective possession of the human race. You know, they're in some ways the collective memory of the human race. You know? And so we need to be able to look at them in each successive age and see what they mean to us or don't any longer mean to us, you know. And to have that argument in some way suppressed, but say you can't do that, I think that's a big problem, because we do need to be able to look at our history and reinterpret it in the light of our present, you know, and reject it or remake it or whatever. We have to be free to do that, I think.
In that same essay, Is Nothing Sacred, you offer a metaphor for the novel as a privileged space to have these kinds of debates and to open these closed stories up. You say, imagine this. You wake up one morning and find yourself in a large, rambling house. As you wander through it, you realize it is so enormous that you will never know it all. In the house are people you know, family members, friends, lovers, conflicts, and colleagues, and also many strangers. The house is full of activity, conflicts and seductions, celebrations and wakes. At some point you understand that there's no way out. You find that you can accept this. The house is not what you'd have chosen. It's in fairly bad condition, and corridors are often full of bullies, but it will have to do. Then one day you enter an unimportant looking little room. The room is empty, but there are voices in it, voices that seem to be whispering just to you. you recognize some of the voices. Others are completely unknown to you. The voices are talking about the house, about everyone in it, about everything that is happening and everything has happened and should happen. Some of them speak exclusively in obscenities. Some are bitchy, some are loving, some are funny, some are sad. The most entertaining voices are all these things at once. You begin to go to the room more and more often. Slowly you learn that most of the people in the house use such rooms sometimes, yet the rooms are all discreetly positioned and unimportant looking.
It's the idea of literature as a toilet.
I thought of that passage both when I was reading this one and when you described your father as sort of having this prescient sort of name change. Ooh. It seems to me that's your definition of not just the novels that you had already written, but the novels to come. I mean, these bitchy voices, these funny voices, these crude voices, every voice.
Well, I think that's, you know, somewhere in that essay, it says literature is the place where you can hear people speaking about everything in every possible way.
Yeah.
You know, and that's its value. It's no one book. It's no special text. It's no special way of speaking. It's where everything can be said in every manner.
Right.
You know, that makes it precious, because that's another name for that is liberty.
Liberty. Before I open it up to audience questions, as I'm going to do after maybe one more and a follow-up, I just want to ask you about some of the politics in this book. Specifically, you're treating New York City and the gin and the wonder tales. Some of the buildings that you create are wondrous and are possibly metaphorical. Sometimes you make the explicit tie to 9/11, so it's not a surprise that terrorism appears in this book. It's also a great book about climate change. Was that conscious, or did that just sort of arise?
No, it was. I mean, this is one of the things I was trying to say about the world has become strange, and some of that is what we've done to it. You know, that, you know, we've invented new weather. We've invented this thing called the polar vortex that didn't exist 3 years ago, and now there it is. It shows up every winter. I mean, so that idea that we are part of the reason for the strangeness, you know, that is bedeviling us, you know, it was very conscious. It is a sort of, I guess, I don't think I've really written a sort of environmentalist novel before, but it does have that element in it.
Have you read Ben Kunkel's New Yorker piece on how climate change is starting to be dealt with in fiction?
I actually did. I did start reading it, and then I stopped reading it.
Me too, actually.
Yeah.
It's long. For our attention spans. But no, I thought it was remarkable to see that buttressing up against points where you look at how terror is the result of kind of a compartmentalization of religious belief, where it congeals into a fanaticism. But there's just that denialism of the other person or the other tradition as valid. And then lately people have been talking about the numbers of sort of white, you know, people get shot down because of white extremism in the US, and we don't call that terrorism, but if it's a brown person, we call it terrorism.
Yeah.
If you do the math, it sort of skews in the direction of the white people are killing a lot more. But if you do the math in terms of climate change, this is a kind of denial that could really destroy all of us.
Yeah, I mean, there is that, you know, bubbling under the surface of the book, and sometimes
and it's never too explicit,
up.
But it'll, no. A lot of the time you can sort of see it there yourself.
But it also, and this is comes back to the optimism. The book also suggests that we're not all doomed. You know, and one of the things there's so much dystopia around these days. You know, everybody seems to want to write books about how awful everything is. And I mean, starting with young adult fiction, which is all, as far as I can see, dystopic right now. And novels are very bleak right now. And one of the things that I learned as an absolute truth from the study of history, which was my university subject, is that history is not set on tram lines. You know, history is not inevitable. Those people who have a kind of determinist view that it must inevitably go a certain way are always wrong. I mean, it can be worse.
Right.
You know,
the optimist can be wrong too.
The optimist it can be worse than you expect, but it can also be better. And what is certain is that it will be different than you expect. I mean, to give just one simple example, if we had been sitting here in January of 1989, and I had said to you, the Soviet Union will not exist at Christmas time, you would have thought I was crazy, mm-hmm. you know, because it seemed to be solidly, permanently there. And then it just blew away. And I mean, now somebody's trying to put it back together, right. But that's a, right. But that's another thing.
That's a separate
what
question.
I'm saying is that these very rapid left turns or knight's moves can happen in human affairs. And so it's very rash to assume that what looks like it's going to happen is inevitably what's going to happen. You know, things can change. And especially in this very, very, as I was saying, accelerated and metamorphic time. And so I just asked myself the question, if you don't want to write a book in which everything's horrible and then it gets worse and then it ends badly, if that's not the book you want to write, what else might we be able to imagine as a future? You know, and it tries to answer that question less absolutely gloomily than a lot of people are answering it right now. I mean, it's not completely, you know, Pollyanna-ish, because right. it does suggest that it might take 1,000 years for us to...
For our dust to start debating again.
Yeah, for us to get to a better place. You know? I don't think it's going to happen the day after tomorrow.
Right.
But anyway, yeah, I just...
So as a reader, you weren't interested in a totally bleak book, and maybe that points to lessons for the people who know that the science of climate change is pretty bleak, but the messaging... maybe won't land as effectively.
Well, I also think that human beings have an incredibly powerful survival instinct, you know, and that survival instinct usually doesn't kick in until it needs to,
right.
you know. But when the survival of the individual or of the group or of, in this case, the human race, or certainly of Miami, you know.
Right. Which, coastal cities,
which may be the same thing, but you know, when New Orleans, you know, when that's really an issue, I mean, I have a sort of suspicion that people will apply themselves to the problem, you know, and it would be nice to do it in advance,
yeah,
you know, before the, you know, the waters are lapping, you know, in around the midtown areas,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
So. But anyway, I'm just, this is my one little gesture towards optimism, that maybe we still have it in us to save ourselves. You know, maybe not.
Well, I want to turn to audience questions now, but let's thank him for coming.
Thank you. Thank you.
So if you'd like to ask a question, please line up behind that microphone. If you could pull it out from where it's sitting so we can see you. Don't be shy. And I think it should be on. And it looks
where
like you're being shy. Greg is going to pull it out. It's just behind that wall. I see some people going for the mic. And keep your questions brief so that other people can ask them, please.
At what point in the writing process do you think of the title?
Well, it varies, is the answer. I mean, sometimes I've known the title all along, and sometimes it arrives later. I mean, in this case, what happened in this case? I had it pretty early, because at a certain point I just asked myself, 1,001 nights, what is that in English? You know, and I just started trying to work it out. And then I got rather delighted by the fact that inside this famous symmetrical number of 1,001, there was another shapely number of 2/8/28, you know, 2 years, 8 months, 28 nights. I thought, you know, how elegant that the famous symmetrical number contains another beautiful number. And at that point, I thought, well, it's got to be the title. I did get, at one point, there were people in Random House who got a little worried about the length of the title, and who said, you know, it's really long, and nobody will be able to remember it, and people will say it wrong, and can't you think of a shorter title? So there was a moment when I did start thinking of a shorter title, and then I just thought, you know, I'm sorry, that's what this book is called. And so it stuck. And I mean, it struck me, and I mentioned this to people in Random House, that there was a time when people didn't mind so much about long titles. And I was just thinking about, for example, The Extraordinary Adventures of the Ingenious Gentleman, Don Quixote de la Mancha, and his Hidalgo. You know, nobody minded that. You know, I mean, yes, they shortened it. I mean, you can shorten this. You call it Huckleberry Finn. No, it's fine, as long as you buy it.
Hello. My question is about the female characters in your books. They're always very strong, very powerful, and it's something that you contrast with the male characters quite evenly, and I find that to be very unique. So in terms of the inspiration for your female characters, if you could speak to that a bit.
Yeah, no, that's a great question. Thank you. I mean, first of all, I really like it that the hero of this novel is female. I mean, the person who arrives to save the world is a female character. And I mean, the answer is I grew up in a family full of people like that. I mean, my family is much more female than male. You know, I mean, I have three sisters and no brothers. And even if you look at the larger extended family of aunts and uncles and cousins and so on, there's an enormous preponderance of women over men in my family. I've actually somehow broken the pattern, and I have two sons and no daughters, but that's very, very unusual in my family. And so I grew up around this quite large crowd of noisy women, you know, I mean, who were all very assertive and brilliant in many cases, and didn't take any shit. And growing up around them, I mean, that became the female world that I was most familiar with, you know. And so I think, and it's very much the opposite of the cliche of the Eastern woman, of the Indian woman, as being kind of recessive and demure and walking three steps behind the man. I mean, that's any woman in my family was asked to walk three steps behind a man would use that position to kick him. Anyway, nobody would dare to ask them. What I'm saying is that I was always surrounded by very strong female characters, and I think they've just given me sort of inexhaustible models for people in my books. You know? So I find it more natural, easier to write about those kinds of women than recessive, quiet, you know, demure women. There's not many of those in my books.
Okay, it's a comment and a question. When I was first...
Come right up to the microphone, please.
When I was first teaching and looking for motivations for my students, I had a logic book that the little stories that were motivating logic were about ogres and genies. And there are little puzzles in them. And I didn't know that they came from 1001 Arabian Nights. So I went around and I found a little Arabian Night written for children, and I read it, and I didn't know that there were more stories. Now, you mentioned it, and I would like to, you said that the 1001 Arabian Nights doesn't exist, but what book should I go to? Maybe I can make up some more puzzles.
I don't know. I mean, there are large numbers of these anthologies, some of which contain stories of the jinn. I mean, the 1001 Nights is one. There's an even longer collection coming out of Kashmir in India called The Ocean of the Streams of Story, which is even more volumes than the Arabian Nights. And so, and not all of them are stories about the jinn, but they're in there somewhere.
Are they in English or?
They're translated. I mean, the problem is that I don't think there's a very big kind of like commercial translation. You're going to have to find it, you know, in some kind of secondhand bookstore or whatever. But
and
I mean, that's the problem.
Be?
That there are not many, you know, easily commercially available anthologies of the lives of the jinn. You know, you have to go and dig them up, I'm afraid. And these stories are the point about a lot of these stories is that they're just oral stories. You know, that it's an oral tradition as much as anything. And in India, for example, people still use the jinn to explain things. You know, so if you're if your car has a flat tire, you know, you might say that a gin did it to you. If you know, if you spill a glass of wine, you know, you can blame a genie. So that it's not just that there are stories, it's that they're used colloquially in everyday speech, you know, still as kind of gremlins, you know, as people who are around to make trouble.
You get the suggestion in the Cairo trilogy that may be the case in Egypt,
yes,
for instance.
In Egypt,
because
they're
it starts
all over
with
the
his
place.
Wife thinking about the gin in the house when he's not there. When he's out drinking, she's thinking about the gin who are there. Which
yes,
is alone.
And there are things you shouldn't do, like go into darkened rooms, you turn the light on before you go in, and things like that. There's yeah. all kinds of legends of the gin. But I mean, I wish I could give you a better answer. I can't, I'm afraid. You just have to dig around.
But thank you anyway for bringing that up.
Yeah, thank you.
But in English, is the Burton translation the
Burton
standard?
Translation is the worst translation.
But it's the best-selling, maybe?
But it's the most enjoyable because of the footnotes. Because this is Richard Burton, not the actor, who did a famous translation of the 1001 Nights, in which sometimes the footnotes are longer than the text.
Right.
And the footnotes are all about deviant sex. I'm sorry to tell you.
Right.
And the footnotes tell you a lot more about Sir Richard Burton.
There's a whole Freudian analysis to be done on the footnotes. Yeah.
So, I mean, if you happen to want to read eight volumes, of which half the page is about deviant sex, the bottom half, and the
not?
Top half is the
so
story.
That would, I don't think that would work
that,
for
that
you.
That may not work for your children. But actually, there are other very good translations. There's a translation by a couple of people called Mathers and Madras.
That's
a four-volume translation, and that's pretty colloquial and good, I think. That's probably the best available right now, and that you can get in paperback, you know, readily, I think. Four volumes. The other thing about the jinn, which is interesting, is that although they occur a lot in these traditions, they're actually even older than that. They're really pre-Islamic. You know, the stories of the jinn go back a very long way. And as I say, they crop up both in the Arabic-speaking world and in the Persian-speaking world and in India. So they've been around.
Yeah.
They've been around.
You give them the little earlobes, and I was thinking of how in Buddhist art the long earlobes mean enlightenment.
Yes. Well, the way you identify the children of the jinn is that they have no earlobes. So you just look at your neighbors. And you see. But actually, where I stole that from is that the people who actually had no earlobes were the Habsburg dynasty of Spain and of Austria-Hungary.
Plenty of sex going on there.
If you go in the Prado Museum and look at the portraits of the Habsburgs, like Philip II of Spain and so on, no earlobes.
Yeah.
And then I was doing an interview the other day with an Australian journalist, and he said to me, you know, Hugh Jackman has no earlobes.
Yeah. That guy's always been suspicious. Well, we'll get to your question, but when you read the parts about the jinn, you do think of the Greek gods and their interactions with mortals.
Yeah, and I mean, I've always, one of the things, I'll just say this quickly and then we'll get to your question. So the one of the things that really interests me about some of these old mythologies, the Greeks, the Romans, and the Nordic myths, is that they all contain the idea that the time will come when the gods withdraw. You know, that in Roberto Colasso's wonderful book, The Marriage of Cadmus and Harmony, he pinpoints that event, the marriage feast of Cadmus, who's reputedly the inventor of the alphabet, and the myth and the nymph Harmonia, that wedding feast is the last time, he says, in the entire literature, the last time that the gods come down from the mountain and mingle with human beings. They come to the wedding feast. But after that, the gods retreat to Olympus and do not take part in human affairs. You know, whereas previously, they'd been very involved. They were taking sides in the Trojan War and you know so on.
Yeah.
But after that, they don't, and then it's just up to us to get on with it. And the Norse myths have the same idea of the thing that we call the twilight of the gods, the Götterdämmerung, you know, is actually this colossal battle in which the gods have to face their ancient rivals and destroy them, but are also destroyed by them. So after that event, there are no more gods, you know, and it's just, again, it's up to us.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that idea that the human race in some way outgrows religion and has to reach a point at which we just have to make our own way. I think it's quite attractive because it connects the mythology to me to actual human life in terms of growing up. You know, that when we are children, we have large godlike figures, you know, who take care of us and who give us rules and who tell us what is right action and wrong action and discipline us if we are not good. And we need their guidance and their love. And then as we get older, we branch out, you know, and we make our own lives, and we don't anymore look in the same way towards our parents for that kind of guidance or authority, you know. And so I think there's something about the polytheistic pantheons, you know, which in a way reflects that initial parental quality of the gods, who then have the sense to say, okay, you're grown up now, you know, go.
You have your philosopher's dust actually say that it's not that God doesn't exist.
Yeah.
It's that, you know, the parents that were the gods want you to...
They want you to grow up. They want you to grow up. And, I mean, it seems to me that's a very sophisticated thing in the Greek and Roman and Nordic religions. So those were religions. I mean, we now call them myths. But there was a time when those were the Greek religion, the Roman religion, and the Nordic religion. And they had temples and priests and so on. But... now they're just stories, but that's, I find that very attractive. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Good afternoon. I don't read fiction. I've never read any of your work, sir. So my question is this the right Salman Rushdie book with all the weight that name conveys?
Absolutely.
To read?
Yes.
Or if not, yeah. What would be?
No, I mean, I'm saying go backwards. I'm saying, you know, start now and go backwards, I would say. In which case, you'll read my worst book last.
You think Grimes was your worst?
Well, I just think with Grimes that I hadn't quite found my way as a writer, and I mean, it's okay. It's a first novel, you know, and there are people who like it. I'm happy to say, I don't like it that much. I find it very fitful. If I look at it, I can see there's a bit. I think, oh yeah, okay, that's all right. And then there are pages which make me want to hide behind the furniture. And it's a, you know, it's a young, I mean, I was what, 26?
But does what you just, does that imply that you don't think Midnight's Children and the Satanic Verses are among the best? Because I do.
Not for me to say, really. I mean, I think what I think about them is that I wrote them a really long time ago, you know? I mean, when Midnight's Children came out, when I finished it, I was 33. You know, when it came out, I was 34. Now I'm 68. You know, so it's literally half my life ago. Right. And the Satanic Verses also. I mean, you know, I wrote it in the sort of second half of the 80s. So by the time it came out was 1988. I mean, I finished it a year before that, so 1987. So it's 28 years ago. Yeah. You know, that I finished 32 years ago that I started. It just feels. You know, that right. was me then.
Right, right.
And like most writers, I'm more interested in me now.
Yeah.
Than
or
me
even
then.
The next one.
Or even the next one. But I mean, it's just that, you know, you go through a life and you explore ideas and ways of writing and so on, and by exploring them you find the next thing, and so it's a kind of journey, you know. When I look at those books, I mean, I'm very proud of them, you know. I am. I'm very proud of them. But they're not what I'm doing now.
Yeah.
I'm trying to do something else now, you know? So rewinding the tape is not such a bad idea.
Yeah, yeah.
No, I mean, I'm in favor of Midnight's Children and the Satanic Verses, but you'll get there.
thank you. First of all, I just wanted to make an acknowledgement for people who aren't aware, because of Mr. Rushdie, a Syrian writer whose greatest crime was writing about the truth, was jailed for 3 years. Mr. Rushdie shared the Pinter Prize with him. And in part because of that, that gentleman, Mohsen Darwish was freed in August of this year. And I think he deserves a very generous acknowledgement of that. I think it was a
Shall
tremendous.
Shall we applaud that?
All right. Well, I mean, thank you, Mohsen Darwish, a wonderful young man who was jailed and tortured and et cetera by what, as you'd expect from Mr. Assad's goons. But what it shows is, I think, and it's part of the reason why I've spent so long working with Penn American Center and also in other countries, is that shining a spotlight on people really helps. You know, that's to say, terrible things happen in the dark. You know, if you can actually say, we are watching, sometimes it's easier for these tyrants to stop doing the thing that we're watching than to continue. You know, so Penn actually has a very strong record of picking cases and highlighting them and getting those people out of the circumstances they were in. I mean, here in America, this event, the Mazen Darwish event, happened that was a Penn, British Penn event, English Penn event, where I got this award, which I shared with him, and that brought a lot of attention to the case, and now he's out.
Do you mean you got the award and you chose to share it with
him? Yeah, the principle of that award is that, because it's Penn is in part a human rights organization, is that the person who's been given the literary award is asked to choose somebody that they will share it with, right, in order to highlight the case. And I chose Mazen Darwish, and I mean, it was 6 months later, within 6 months, he was free. So that's good. And this year, thank you. I mean, this year's recipient of the same award is the poet James Fenton, and he chose as his person to share it with the Saudi blogger Raif Badawi, who is now, you know, under this weekly sentence of being flogged, which would kill him. And we'll see. I mean, you know, we have to see if that works, but I hope so. But I mean, it is really true that by shining a light on these abuses, it very, very often gets the people released. It really does.
And does Penn get enough credit for being Penn American Center also shines a light on the U.S.'s own surveillance, yes, of U.S. citizens. That got written up in the Times, and I thought that was a wonderful sign.
Yeah, I mean, that was actually when I was president of Penn, which was during the George W.'s first term. And
where he was calling people axis of evil.
Yes, and there were the problems with the Patriot Act, where people were being obliged, bookstores were being obliged to surrender lists of what books people were buying, and were forbidden.
Libraries as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, libraries, et cetera. So there, and Guantanamo, you know, and Abu Ghraib, all of that. And I thought, we can't be a human rights organization with any credibility if we only criticize the human rights abuses of other countries.
Especially, you know, the Pan-American one.
Yeah, because it's an obvious response to say, well, look at what your country's doing. You know, so I thought we have to be equally as clear about calling out the United States for its abuses of human rights if we want to retain any credibility when we talk about other countries. So that was a change that happened, you know, during the time that I was president of Penn, because, you know, this country has an absolute rule, for example, against the use of torture. You know, I mean, it's actually in the laws of this country that this country does not condone or use torture until Dick Cheney. And then suddenly it was okay and justified by incredibly contorted and basically incorrect legal defenses. And it was awful to see the United States becoming a country that tortured people, especially as, you know, all the evidence shows that information gleaned under torture is profoundly unreliable. I mean, people essentially say anything, you know. People will incriminate their grandmothers, you know, when they're in those sort of extreme situations.
And Penn's wonderful Larry Seams did a whole book on that.
Did a whole book about it. He's so, yeah, I mean, I think Penn is a really remarkable organization.
I do too. And I think what you just said, the change that came under your watch, I think also deserves our applause.
Well, thank you.
I had a quick question, if it's okay.
All that is backlog, yeah.
You mentioned shining a light, and you also said something on Bill Maher's show recently I thought was, as someone of Syrian roots, that really hit home for obvious reasons. The source of this cancer in Syria, it may not be the end, but the source of this cancer in Syria is Assad, and until he's removed, you can't have any game change. I was wondering if you would be willing to be part of a movement of citizens of conscience, you being someone who's been willing to up the ante at times, to ask for the removal of Assad, this installation of an interim government, and for him to be tried for war crimes, which I think among Middle East countries would be an enormous step forward to actually have accountability for leaders like him.
I think I'm sort of unofficially anyway, already a member of that kind of a movement. I mean, I'm no fan of Assad. I'm not a great joiner, I have to say, but all I'd say is write to me, and then let's take it up from there. But I sometimes think a writer's voice is best used outside a movement. You know, let's say, if people think you're part of a particular gang, sometimes it's easier to dismiss what you're saying. I'm a great believer in the independent voice of the artist, you know. And but in principle, yes, is the answer. So would you just write to me and we'll take it from there.
Thank you. Mm.
Well, unless there are any other last-minute questions that pop up, would you want to shout your question from the... You're an indispensable audience member.
Yeah, okay, good, the Robin Williams anecdote. So, I mean, I was lucky enough to know him a little bit, and he told me that when he was first hired to voice the genie in Aladdin, it was a relatively small part. And he was paid a relatively small amount of money, like $80,000 or something, to come in for a couple of days and do the bit that had been written. So he did that. And then he said, basically, to the producers, he said, look, I think there's kind of more in this character, and will you just let me have a go? And so they said, all right. So then he spent a day just going, you know? And it was so brilliant, the improvisation, that they actually had to reanimate the film in order to make the character much bigger and put in all the stuff that Robin had done. And then, of course, the film makes a zillion, gazillion dollars, and he's only been paid relatively small amounts of money. So even Michael Eisner, the head of Disney, was a bit guilty. And so, I mean, I was at Robin Williams' house for dinner, and he said, look, this is what he did. He took me into his dining room, and hanging over the mantelpiece was a really good Picasso. And that's what he got given for the genie. So that was Disney's way of saying thanks.
I'm glad you reminded us. Thank you for that. I think I see one more question, and then we'll get to the signing.
Thanks.
And pull that down, please.
Yeah, I'm kind of short. I'm just interested in your approach to the creative process, how you spend your time and structure your day, and if you can just talk about that a little bit.
How do I spend my day?
Actually,
the truth is that the one thing that I have acquired over a long period of time that I've been doing this is really quite good work discipline, you know, so, which I certainly didn't have when I started out, but just, I mean, I realized recently that it's 40 years since the publication of my first book. My first book came out in 1975. Mm. So I've been doing this for more than 40 years. And the thing that I have learned in that period is just get up and do it. You know, and so now I just get up and do it every day. I mean, I'm just sort of I'm so trained to do it that it's easier to do it than not do it. And the sort of the way I describe it to myself is that I tell myself that you wake up every day with a little nugget of creative energy, you know, for that day, and you can use it or you can waste it. Mm-hmm. You know, and if you get up and you make 3 phone calls and answer 10 emails and things like that, it's gone. So what I make myself do is get to the desk immediately that I wake up. I mean, before I have a shower or anything. And I sit there, sometimes for a short time and sometimes for a longer time, until I'm clear what it is until I know what I'm doing today. You know, I think, okay, we're here, we're doing this, and it goes like this, you know? And once I know that, then I can do things like have a shower and get dressed and, you know, be a human being. But that thing, start immediately at the beginning of the day, get yourself underway, you know, and then and no distractions. You know, and so, I mean, so for instance, you know, people, because I'm a little bit sometimes active on Twitter, people ask me about social media, and the truth is that when I'm really writing, I don't go there at all. You know, I just, when I'm actually in the middle of a book, then I completely agree with the kind of Jonathan Franzen position, which is that you don't need that noise in your head. And when I'm not writing a book, sometimes it's kind of fun to interact with readers and so on. But I'm actually very, very good at the kind of now having this kind of tunnel vision of just sitting there. And I think the thing that happens, I think many writers would say this too, is that when you actually have, I mean, it requires quite extraordinary levels of concentration to get into the place from which creative writing can come, you know. And one of the things that does, it has a very peculiar effect on the passing of time. So I very often think I've been sitting there for an hour or so, and I look at my watch and I see that it's 6 hours later, you know. And that happens so often. I think it's just some side effect of the concentration. It's very tiring. I mean, I remember years ago, my editor in England, I was still living in England then, my editor, who was also a sort of neighbor of mine, for some reason rang the doorbell on her way home. And I went and answered the door, and she said, "Oh my God, what's wrong with you?" And I said, "Well, nothing's wrong with me. I've just been working." And she said, "Well, you look horrible." And I said, "I'm sorry, I always look like this at the end of a day's work. This is how I look." You know, and she said, "Oh my God, it's so bad for you." I said, "Yeah, but you know, what else would I do?" So it is very, it's very demanding. But I have actually got into the habit of doing it now. So, and I think that's all it is, it's habit, you know. And what I say to young writers is you've just got to make yourself, you know, you've got to not give yourself permission to not write. You know, you have to make yourself do it. And gradually that becomes habit, and habit becomes process, and process leads to books, and so on.
And you will inevitably look terrible doing it.